按下门，我直接插上就行吗？还有设置吗？
Didn't you see Bandura and the Bogo?
Yeah, I use that.
Yeah.
How do you like use that to create people to be like?
Exactly. That's what I did. Yeah, I used that and I talked about when you can show up your actions to make people trust you. Like,
hopefully,
it's hard to make people like, oh, I'm going to change all this stuff with you. And people are like, well, like, who are you? You know what I mean?
We can use that like to
build like something like that. But yeah, so I have that policy.
How long is the video?
Oh man, I remember it. Okay, last semester was way worse than this semester. I'll tell you that. So that paper took me a while. I kind of procrastinated on it, so I'm saying that I really like almost all do that because I think I stayed up actually all my work.
That seems to be
like that
because I tried to revise.
That we turned in, so it wasn't too bad.
Yeah,
so that made it easier than then you could have it done in the round. And you can watch it up
and find cherry.
So you have like the
hi, how are you?
The results from Romania. But you have different submissions. So first you submit a paper as practice.
She's yours now.
So it's not that bad because we can't change it almost at the same time.
Okay, so we're just gonna, I think, put this microphone.
Yeah, I use the Bandura article.
Yeah. I'm gonna put it here, but maybe if you just sit, just scoot over just a little bit, and that way it can pick up more sound this way. Okay. Yeah, we just want to have the microphone where we can pick up the sound. So we're going to get.
Yes. Okay, so what will I'll advance the slides for you. Do you want to do that?
Or the computer?
Yeah, so this is just because you're transmitting to the outside world, okay? And so actually what we're going to do...
So it will be someone who will...
Yeah, I think what we're going to do is put the podium on this side so that we can show him and the screen. Okay, let's do that. All right.
Okay, and so we can still put that, we can put that here still.
Yeah,
and it's mostly so it will pick up the room, all right? So what we want you to do is that we speak and I'll advance the slides for you, okay? So if you could be standing here so that the screen, so that the people watching online can see the screen, which will pick up the PowerPoint.
Yeah, I'll be careful.
Yeah, you don't have to. No, you can stand here and then just step aside to show the slides. You know, and you can step back in.
Okay.
All right. So, Chun and May, are you also going to be on?
Yes, I will too. Yeah.
So that we can see if people have questions.
Yeah,
so people can pose questions typing, and somebody will read them out if somebody has a question. Okay. So right now we don't have these people online, but people will join us. And then what we want to do is, all right, okay, so you can just PowerPoint and just go along here.
All right, yeah.
Oh, sure, why don't we do that?
Directly.
Yeah, I mean, okay. If you could kind of go back and forth. for
okay,
it.
Okay, so,
so
just read from the book
yeah,
here.
If you don't mind.
Okay, good.
If you don't mind hearing them. So, sometimes we kind of okay, guys, I think that we're ready, and so. So he'll be able to read it if it's just like this.
Yeah.
Okay? Does that see you?
Yeah.
See it okay? So she's kind of checked. Okay, we're finally ready. Thank you for bearing with us, everybody. You know, we tried to bring our presentations to you live here in Fort Collins and also online to those who want to tune in. So we are very pleased to have this particular guest. I want to give you just a little bit of a background. He's a very good friend of mine. We've known each other for quite some time now, so I'm really pleased that he's here. I was given the very wonderful opportunity to go to Romania in 2012 was the first time, invited by another scholar who came to us last year. I went on a Fulbright Senior Specialist, spent some time working at Babes Bouygues University, went back a second time and a third time, and also received this other scholar, Dr. Dan Razio, in the United States a couple of times. So we maintain a relationship, but what I found wonderful, every time I went to Romania, I met the same friends that I knew the time before, and Dr. Mahte was one of them. Last year, we applied for an Erasmus Plus grant with Babes Bouygues University. It's actually a European grant for mobility. It's for transfer of students and faculty between European universities. But last year, they opened it up for partnerships with American universities for the first time, and this Romanian university wanted to partner with us, so that was really wonderful. We did that, and Dr. Razio came last year, and then I went back to Romania one more time, and now Dr. Mahte is here as part of that grant. So when he let me know that he was coming, we talked about, well, what are you going to do some lectures on? Guess what? Because he's from Romania and from Transylvania, we thought, and actually it was his idea to talk about the Dracula myth in popular culture and something that we want to know about as people in arts management and arts policy because it's such a powerful, compelling myth throughout history. So he's going to be talking about that over the course of several meetings. The first one is tonight. So now I'll let him take over.
Okay,
kind of speak a little bit loud
yes,
so that they can.
I was speaking. Be careful about me being here and also reading this.
Okay, so I'll be changing your slides,
yes,
so just give me
please,
a high sign whenever you need
the
to.
The first one. Okay, the topic is to explore the impact of Dracula as a global myth on. This is the topic of the first lecture. On Romanian post-1989 media. I will also explain what happened with the myth of Dracula before 1989, because the story is kind of long. I will start from a very common fact, the fact that nowadays mass media commonly connects the fictional character Dracula with a historical character Vlad Tepes, or Vlad the Impaler. So that's why I will ask you to be patient with me and to pass through all the details concerning the life of Tepes, because they are interesting for the myth itself. If you will take part in this lecture up to the end, you will see that there is a point and there is a reason for my long presentation of Tepes as a connection to Dracula. Next one, please. Thank you. This is just an example of NBC, for example, who on the night of Halloween, of course, they created a news about Dracula, which is connected with Vlad the Impaler. The picture is the picture from the post picture from the 1931 movie Dracula, which was interpreted, Dracula was interpreted by Lugosi. I will talk about Lugosi and about the history of Dracula movies on my third lecture. Some facts about Romania. Nowadays, Romania has an area of 92,000 miles, a population of approximately 19 million. This is the map of Romania, the actual geographical map. Here you can see the Carpathian Mountains, which cross, which run across Romania, which are very important. Yeah, these are the Carpathians. You will see, because the Carpathians are also mythological, but also real, geographical. Okay. Some things about the history of Romania, which connect to Vlad Tepes. There are many stages in Romania's history. Of course, Romania was created as a state at the middle of the 19th century, but up to then there was a Romanian population there. The first that were remembered on these territories were the Dacians, were the ancient people of the Dacia, which were the Dacians. Then very shortly the region was conquered by Romans. Then was, for example, Transylvania was conquered by Hungarian kings. There is a period from the 5th century to the 11th century in Transylvania and also outside the arch of the Carpathians, where we do not have very much information, but we do know that there were a lot of migrations during that period. Also very important, before the 19th century, Romanians lived in three separate provinces, which are historically different. And as you will see, they are also culturally different. The most important, because it is directly connected to Dracula, it is Wallachia, the Principality of Wallachia. Then it is the Principality of Moldavia in the east, and the Principality of Transylvania, which is in the center and center west. Transylvania has a very different history from the other two, because Transylvania was first conquered in the 11th century by Hungarian kings, and Transylvania was more or less ruled by Hungarian nobility up to the 20th century. But also you still have, why it is connected to Romania, because you still have had, before the 19th century, you had a very large Romanian population living on these areas. Although that province belonged to Hungary or to the Hungarian kings or to the Habsburg Empire, the fact was that in 1918, as you will see, Romania the province of Transylvania went to Romania as a part of Romania after the negotiation of the Treaty of Trianon in 1920. I think we will skip this part, because I will also, for details, I will also send you the whole document, so you have time to read it. This is the actual map with the historical, actual nowadays map of Romania with the historical provinces, Moldova in the east, Wallachia, which covers also here, Oltenia. Oltenia is a part of Wallachia, but it's still Wallachia. Dobruja is very important, because Dobruja was conquered by the Turks. It was taken by the Turks at the beginning of the 14th century, and it was a Turkish dominion up to the 19th century. So this region has a strong influence, strong Ottoman influence, and also still today has a kind of important Muslim community, just historical Muslim community here. Transylvania is in the center, but actually historically we named Transylvania, all these parts are actually in Transylvania. This is the Roman conquest of Dacia by the Emperor Trajan. You see, Transylvania was a part of the Dacian conquest and also the south of Romania.
Okay. And can you just explain a little bit more about who the Dacians are? Because
the Dacians are a tribe, a barbarian tribe, which were there before the Roman conquest. The Romans conquered them. They had a historical king, the Sebalus, which was which committed suicide after the victory of Trajan over the Dacians. They are remembered in Roman chronicles. They are remembered as a barbarian people in Roman chronicles. What more did I say?
No, because the Romanians look back to the Dacians as their ancestors.
Yeah, it's a different story. I didn't want to get into that because it's a long story. But the fact was that the fact was that at the beginning of the 19th century, when Romanian nationalism was beginning to take form, Romanian nationalists, historians and intellectuals, especially academics or intellectuals, they tried to find a continuity between the ancient peoples and the Romanians living in the 19th century on these territories. And of course they presented the Dacians as their ancestors. So that's why Romanian history nowadays presents Dacians and Romans as their direct ancestors. There is another thing of history which I will not discuss here. It's about the origin and the legitimacy of this connection, but officially, historically, Romanian history says that we are the heirs of the Dacians and the Romans. So we have a Roman language. That's for sure. Well, we have a Roman origin because the Romans were here, and we also have a Dacian origin. Yes. Thank you. This is the exact map of the day of Roman Dacia in 106 to 75 AD. Actually, the province was conquered because of its resources. As you can see here, you have a lot of salt mines and gold mines. We have the gold mines in the Apuseni Mountains, which are the Transylvanian Alps over there, which were actually dug up. Those resources were dug up from the time of the Romans to the time of the Habsburgs. Okay. This is the map of the Hungarian conquest in the 10th to 11th century of the Carpathian Basin. What the Hungarians call the Carpathian Basin is just this arch over here. This is for them the Carpathian Basin, and this is a part of their history also. This Transylvania is, it has a contested history. That history belongs also to Romanians, but that history, because of the Hungarian conquest, belongs also to, and you will see that because it's connected with the myth of Dracula. It's also creates a legitimacy myth for the Hungarians, and also it's connected to the ancestry of the German Saxons. German Saxons were who inhabited this region. This region of the Carpathian Basin, I mean, basically Transylvania, inhabited it from the 12th century. Okay, this is Transylvania as a part of the Kingdom of Hungary from the 10th to the 16th century. Why the 10th to the 16th? Because I told you before that Transylvania was more or less Hungarian up to 1980, because in the 16th century the Hungarian kingdom collapsed after after the victory of the Turks at Mohács. The Hungarian kingdom split in two or three different parts.
One part was Transylvania, one part was northern Hungary, which was still ruled by Hungarian nobility, but the southern part of Hungary just fell to the Turks. So it became a Russian domain, Turkish domain. Yes. These are the principalities which I was talking about around 1600. So there were the same principalities during the time of Vlad the Impaler, which is one century and a half before 1600. Yes. These are the United Principalities in 1859. This is the first sign of Romania, as it was the first sign of the state of Romania in the 19th century, because the state of Romania was formed by the union in 1859 of these two provinces, which actually belonged up to the 19th century. From the 15th century to the 19th century, they belong to Ottoman influence. They were strongly influenced by Ottoman. They were not ruled by Ottomans directly, but they were ruled by princes who were actually named as rulers by the Ottomans. So these two provinces show, even today, they show a lot of Turkish or Ottoman influence, or a lot of Balkanic influence, whereas Transylvania is different in cultural terms from these two provinces. Okay. This is a map of Austro-Hungarian Empire in 1910. As you will see here, Transylvania still belongs to the Habsburg Empire in 1910. And what you see here is an ethnic map. And what you see here with green, there are the Hungarians, and with orange are the Romanians here. So as you will see, the Romanians are spread all over Transylvania and up to Bukovina. But the Hungarians live, and they are still living today as a minority. They live here at the corner of the Carpathians, and of course here in Hungary. But what is interesting about this map is that you have at least 10 nationalities in the Austro-Hungarian Empire. That's one of the reasons why the Austro-Hungarian Empire collapsed in 1918, because all these nationalities declared independence after after the defeat of the Austro-Hungarian army. Yes. The Kingdom of Romania, this is the Kingdom of Romania 1914, the exact map of the Kingdom of Romania 1914. As you see, they had Dobruja, but they didn't have Bukovina in the north, and they didn't have Transylvania, 1914. 1914 is the first year of the First World War. This is Romania 1980. You see the difference. Actually, in 1980, Romania got doubled the size. Its size got doubled because it is united with all the territories that would live by majoritarily by Romanians. This territory here, which is now not Romanian territory, it is the different republic, the Republic of Moldova. This had a Romanian majority, as Transylvania, Banat, Maramureș, Bukovina had a Romanian majority. That's why they united at the end of the First World War. Yes. After World War II, Romania lost these territories, which he acquired in 1980. This republic, the Socialist Republic of Moldavia, got to the USSR. This part got to Ukraine, and this part got to Bulgaria. So this is the map of Romania nowadays, the violet. Okay. This is the ethnic map of Romania nowadays. The biggest minority, as you see there with red, is the Hungarian minority. So we have a Hungarian minority in the center of Romania, up to the west of Romania. So all that part is made of Hungarian minority. We also have minorities, ethnic Turkish minorities, and the Tatar minorities here in Dobruja, as I was telling you. religions, of course, nowadays in Romania, they are ethnically divided. Orthodox religion is throughout the country, the majority of religion, 80%, 80% of 100%. But we also have Roman Catholics, which are Hungarians, but not just Hungarians. They are also Romanian Greek Catholics. They are also Romanian Roman Catholics. They are also Hungarian Roman Catholics, and they are also Hungarian Protestants. So we have a lot of denominations there, and we also have historical Muslims, Turkish Muslims here, which still. Yeah, so it's a map of no trouble. It's a map of a diversity of religions there. Also, you have to see here the diversity of non-Orthodox religion in Romania. The Orthodox is the this gray area here, but the non-Orthodox area here, you see the spread of Neo-Protestantism in Moldavia. You also see the spread of Neo-Protestantism throughout Transylvania, and also see, you see that the geographical map almost coincide with the ethnic and the religious map, because it's almost you can see here very clearly to the map this Transylvania is different in terms of ethnic, religious, and culture of difference from the other two regions, which are more compact, more homogeneous. Here we have diversity, here we have more or less homogeneity. Here we have a huge diversity of religions and denominations. Yes. About Brad Dracula, because I have to tell something about his name. What does it mean, what Dracula? Dracula was Vlad III, actually. Was named Vlad Tepes after his death, Vlad the Impaler. He was known as Vlad Dracula. What is the name Dracula? It is the English translation of the Romanian name Dracula, which means son of Dracula. What does Dracula mean? It means two things. It means the devil, of course, but it also means what it meant to Vlad III. The fact that he was a member of the Order of the Dragon. He was knighted, he was knighted a knight of the Order of the Dragon because his father was the first from the Dracula family to the, it's a family. So you have a Dracula family, you have a Dracula bloodline there. Well, I said it, bloodline. you have a Dracula bloodline. You have the first Dracula was the grandfather of Vlad III, but the first Dracula was the father because he was the first to be named Dracul or Dragon. Yes, Dracul is in Romania, but Dragon is his name. It was just a chivalric name. So from this name, Dracul, the one who is part of the Order of the Dragon, he got the name Dracula, which is the English translation of Dracula. He lived from 1431 to 1476, not much, and he ruled in Wallachia, not Transylvania, he ruled in Wallachia. He was Prince of Wallachia three times, 1448, 1466 to 62, which was the longest reign in the bloodiest, and 1476, but he ruled just 1 month and then got killed. Okay. Vlad ruled three times over the southern province of nowadays Romania called Wallachia. During his reigns, Wallachia was under the Ottoman influence and it was not an Ottoman province, yet its rules were controlled by the Sultan. So he had a complex history. He was actually the son of Vlad II. Vlad II was he was pressured by both the Ottomans and the Hungarians to pledge his loyalty to one or the other, and he pendulated between these loyalties, because that was a very rough time for that province. And as a ruler, he switched sides many times, as Vlad switched sides. His first Vlad, what's the history of Vlad? Very shortly, the Vlad, this one, the Vlad III, Vlad Tepes, what's his history? His history is that he had He had also two brothers. The first one, the biggest one, was killed with his father. The eldest one, which was Radu, he was the first one, Mircea, was killed, so he's out of the picture. But his other brother, Radu, was important because he will be a rival of Vlad Dracula at the rule of Wallachia. And why? Because at some point in time, his father has been asked by the Sultan to go to Adrianople, which is now the Turkish city of Edirne, and to pledge loyalty to the Sultan. He went there with his family. He went home, but his two sons did not go home because the Sultan kept them to assure the father's loyalty. So he kept his two sons, Vlad III and Radu. He kept them prisoners. They were not imprisoned. They were actually royal prisoners at a Ottoman castle in Edirne. But it was very important because it was the childhood of Dracula, and he, during his childhood, from 12 years to 18 years, he was educated by the Ottomans. So he knew Turkish, Persian. He had knowledge of the Quran. Of course, he didn't take Muslim religion. So he didn't accept Muslim religion, but he was educated in all these minutiae of Muslim rulers. Actually, he was educated by the Turks to become a ruler of Wallachia. And what best way to assure loyalty of a prince, but to educate him at your court, in your customs, in your language? Actually, Dracula spoke perfectly Turkish. He was very well acquainted with the method of the Turks. He was very well acquainted with the Sultan. He was a friend first when he was in that school. He was a friend of the Sultan, the Mehmed II, the Sultan, which of course then became his biggest enemy. So that's the story of Dracula. He became Prince of Wallachia with the help of the Turks, because the Turks sent him after 17, they sent him to Wallachia to rule. Of course, with the security that he will rule for them. And he switched sides. He switched sides. He didn't pay the tribute anymore, and he switched sides. And of course, he tried to get another loyalty, because you had a very small province, which was between two empires, and you had to be vassaled to some of the biggest powers. So you have to ally with the Hungarians or the Turks. So he switched sides to the Hungarians, and he became an ally of the Hungarians, as his father became an ally of Hungarians before him. What are Vlad's connection to Transylvania? Well, Vlad's connection to Transylvania are very important. First, he was born in Transylvania because during that time his father was a noble protected by the Kingdom of Hungary. His father, Vlad II, switched sides. He went to Transylvania. He became a noble there, and of course, he got the protection of the King of Hungary. Vlad was his son. He was born in the town of Sighișoara, Transylvania. Actually, historical facts are not that clear. It may be just a story that he was really born in Sighișoara. Probably he spent the first 5 years of his time in Sighișoara, but it is not very. It's allegedly Timișoara. Sighișoara is allegedly his city of birth, but he may well have been born in Wallachia. We don't have historical sources about this. Also, he married Transylvanian women. Vlad Țepeș, he was married with two Transylvanian noblewomen. The first one is, her name is unclear, but the second one is clear. It's Justina Sida de Horoshek. It's a Hungarian noblewoman, part of the Szekély Hungarian noble family. What is the story with Szekély Hungarian? Szekélyes are those minorities that you have seen there in the corner of the Carpathians. They are called themselves Szekélyes. Of course, now they are Hungarian, they speak Hungarian. But in the 15th century, Szekély and Hungarian were different nationality. Although they spoke the same language, they probably have different historical origins. But they became, when Transylvania was conquered, they became subject to the King of Hungary, and they took Hungarian as their language. But during the all the Middle Ages, the Szekély considered themselves a different nation. Although they speak Hungarians as the Hungarians, they didn't consider themselves as Hungarians. Why is this important? It is important because you will see the Szekélyes in the book about Dracula. When Dracula speaks of himself, he will speak of himself as a Szekély, which is, wow, why is he Hungarian in the book of Bram Stoker, and why is he not Romanian in the book of Bram Stoker? It's a huge story. I will develop it further in my lectures, okay? So he was married with a noble woman from a Szekély family, and his offsprings were not just Romanian. They were also they will have his offspring from this part of the family, the Horoshe family. They will also have Szekély nobility. So they will be half Romanian and half Szekély nobility, which is very important. Yes. Thank you. During his second reign, how the myth of Dracula became the myth of Dracula. This is the story that, the first part of the story that created the myth of Dracula. The myth of Dracula, not of the vampire, but of Dracula Țepeș, was known from the 15th century on. So the first chronicles who spoke about Dracula and his horrors and his atrocities were the German Saxons, which he attacked while he was ruler of Wallachia. Because the German Saxons, who lived at the outskirts of Transylvania, they hosted rival leaders to Wallachia. And he attacked the Saxons to repay them for their treason to him. And these chronicles, the German Saxon chronicles, they told the story of Dracula the Impaler. They made the story of Dracula the Impaler circulate throughout the Central Europe, throughout whole Central Europe. So this is how the myth of Dracula, the first myth, not the vampire myth, which is Stoker's, a different thing. The first myth, the Dracula Țepeș or Dracula the Impaler, this is how the first myth was made. Of course, those chronicles say that he was a ruthless and bloodthirsty tyrant because he was cruel in executing his punishments. Of course, his favorite punishment was impaling, which was not invented by Dracula. It was also done by the Turks. He saw this punishment at the Turks. First, the Turks, because it's a terror tactic. Actually, it's a very good terror tactic. He was a terrorist. Yes, he was a terrorist because he used terror tactics. For example, he used impalement not just against the Germans in Transylvania, but also against the Turks. When he switched sides, the Turks came to Wallachia. How did he repel, rejected them? How did he repel those armies of the Turks? Very simply. He took prisoners and he impaled the prisoners. Well, how would you feel to see 20,000 prisoners impaled? That story is a story which is told not by the Saxon chronicles, it is told by the Turkish chronicles, who say that the Sultan went back across the Danube when he saw his 20,000 Turks impaled. That was his Dracula's terror tactic when against the Turks, when the Turks attacked his country. So you can say that he may well have been a bloodthirsty criminal tyrant, but he used this tactic very well. And also used it, but not on this scale. The difference with him is that he used it on a massive scale. He used impediment on a massive scale. Of course, that method of killing was not a killing in itself. It was a torture, actually. That method of killing was so atrocious that it was also a terror tactic for the ones who used it. Okay. Text about blood impaler. He had two brothers, as I told her already. Mircea killed in 1447, and Radu, his stepbrother, known as Radu the Beautiful, who was also imprisoned at Ottoman court from 1442 with Tepes. Yet these were royal prisoners who were treated as nobility. Radu and his brother were taught in the arts of war. They learned Turkish and Persian, were schooled in the Quran, studied logic. Vlad left the Sultan's court in 1448 to gain his throne. Radu embraced Islam. Differently from his father, from his brother, Radu embraced Islam. He became a Muslim and eventually became an Ottoman military leader. However, Radu became Vlad's rival for the throne and later marched in a campaign against Tepes. Okay. This is the most famous portrait of Vlad the Impaler, is the portrait which is kept at the Castle Ambras in Austria, in Innsbruck, at the Kunst und Wunderkammer. Kunst und Wunderkammer is the cabinet of curiosities. So he was considered a monster, already in the 16th to 17th century. His portrait was in the cabinet of curiosities. Cabinet of curiosities is a monster cabinet. And it is very common to the period of the 16th to the 17th century. You can also see Wunderkammers in Prague. You have the Wunderkammer, in the Strahov Monastery in Prague. If you go there or if you went there, you have seen it. Okay. Now I will just keep to the figure of Dracula today. This is a long introduction about who Vlad Impaler was, known as Dracula. Now I will talk just about Dracula as it is seen today. Nowadays, Dracula, aka Vlad Impaler, serves as a tourist icon for tourist operators in Romania and abroad. Part of the opening of the markets in East Europe was, as one important commentator said, exotic for the Western gaze strategy, which attracts tourists, especially from Western Europe and the North American continent. In other words, the strategy often proposes reorientalizing as a publicity strategy for the Western tourists. What do I say here? I say that Dracula myth is a Western, the Dracula tourist myth, the Dracula as a tourist icon, is first and foremost a Western myth. It is a myth created by Western tourists and then relocated to Transylvania. So this myth of Dracula as Vlad the Impaler, especially located to a special place, a special geographical place, is a myth which is created not by history, not by Romanians, but by Western tourists. It's very important because this relates to a theory about tourism which exoticizes this region, which is the region of Transylvania, and balkanizes it and transforms it into the fictive region that you have, that you will see or you have seen in Bram Stoker's novel. So it's a kind of orientalizing, exoticizing the East to the purpose of the Western tourist. Okay. In the case of Dracula pop culture, because we already have a Dracula pop culture. Halloween is a Dracula pop culture. it includes a diagram of culture. The man with the cape. The man with the cape is a myth which comes from the movie Dracula from 1931 with Bela Lugosi. So that was the first moment when you see Dracula as the man with the cape, which is more like a circus freak, you know, like something like a.
That's because he's a bat.
Something like, yeah, this is a bad, I mean, someone with a vaudeville mind created that kind of image, with a bat, with a cape, with red, with fangs and everything. But that image was created in that movie, the 1931 Hollywood, first Hollywood famous Dracula movie with Bela Lugosi. Okay, so. In the case of Dracula pop culture, the strategy of primitivization addresses primitivization of the region, because you don't have you don't just have the monster tyrant, which is Vlad the Impaler. You also have the monster country, which is Transylvania. You have the monster tyrant and the monster country. So the territory in itself will become a character in the narrative of Dracula as Vlad the Impaler. Tourism image strategies may reduce Transylvania to a few primitivistic cliches, more or less monstrous, more or less positive. Beautiful wildlife, untamed nature, spectacular mountains, ancestral inhabitants, beautiful peasants, old castles, spectacular mountain roads, ancient local food, etc. So this is part of an image strategy. This is part of an image narrative. Of course, seeing all remnants of the past and all natural heritage as primitivistic is as dangerous as the real primitivistic cliché-ization itself. Of course, we don't have to fall into that trap. The touristic gaze often relies on fantasizing. All the tourist gaze rely on fantasizing, mythologizing about the object. For example, you have here in the U.S. you have Disneyland. Of course, this is a pure example of fantasizing, of mythologizing about something, even a fictional one. I mean, if you have a Disneyland, how could you not have a Dracula or a Dracula park? So this is part of the image of tourism, which mythologizes, fantasizes about its object. So the tourist doesn't go to a country to see that country. No, he goes to a country to see an image of that country, which he already has created or has been created for himself. So tourism is a strategy of imaging as self-imaging. You don't get to the U.S. as a tourist to see all the things in the U.S. No, you get to the U.S. When you get to the U.S., you get to the U.S. as Rocky Mountains, as Disneyland, as Hollywood, as I don't know, New York, the Statue of Liberty, as
Grand Canyon,
of course.
Maybe not Trump.
This is the last thing in that fantasy world of tourism. Yes, of course. We'll delete that, of course, after our meeting. The trouble is that tourism also relies on cliches. You cannot escape cliches in tourism. Even myself, if I go here, what do you want to see? What do I want to see? I of course I want to see the houses, which are also a cliche to me, because since I've never been to the U.S., my cliche was that America is made of these houses, this kind of houses, this kind of neighborhood, this kind of way of life, etc., etc. But to me, it is an image. I don't know the reality of the thing. I cannot get. I'm a tourist here. I cannot get the reality of the things here. So this happens with every tourist, with the American tourist, with the Japanese, the Chinese, the Romanian tourist, everywhere. Because when he goes to another country, he goes. In one way or another, he goes to cliches, even the cliches which he imagines himself, all the cliches which are done for him. But the problem with the cliche theory is that you cannot see everything as a cliche, because that theory can also be a cliche. That's the problem with the cliche theory. You have the cliche, well, everything is a cliche. Yeah, but isn't that theory also a cliche? So you have a problem with, you have an ideological problem with this. That's why I put this disclaimer at the bottom of the presentation. It's, you have to be careful about tourism. And then what does happen, really? The touristic gaze and race and fantasizing. Tourism actually is an art. It is a savoir-faire. It is a know-how. It is a question of cultural policy, but at a personal level. When you are a tourist, you do cultural policy, not officially, but on a very personal level. You did why? Because you have choices. You make choices. And this is cultural policy 101. You could say, I make choices. I want to see that, to see that. This is cultural policy. Okay. The most intriguing thing for a tourist and for a tourist agent is that he is himself the receiver and the interpreter of historical and cultural fact and truth. He is the interpreter of the fact. You don't have the fact. You have the interpretation of the fact. Well, I don't want to get involved in that philosophical thing, but this is the situation. It's not the truth, it's the situation. Preserving the middle ground between primitivistic cliché and its counterpart, which is the anti-primitivistic cliché, because this is also a cliché, it's the most difficult thing to do with theory. That is because exaggeration and truth are always intermingled in this cultural experience called tourism. Always intermingled. Well, when I make tourism, I make the experience of clichés, but I also make my own experience. My own experience, which remains with me. It's not a cliché. It's a personal one. And that's why tourism is always, in tourism, there are always exaggeration and truth in the main. Because after a tourist experience, that experience has also truth in it, which is very interesting. It's very interesting. So that's why tourism is an art. It's a personal art. It's a personal savoir-faire. It may be less personal when the tour guide guides you. And you go like, okay, let's go with the tour guide. And he will show this and that. Okay. But even if you go to the tour guide, that experience is yours. If you go with the tour guide, that experience is yours. So tourism is a cultural experience where exaggeration and truth intermingles. And that's why it's very tough to say that, well, okay, these clichés about Transylvania are just clichés. No, they are not just clichés. They are also truthful experiences. So you have to decide. It's a very tough thing to do, okay? So, Dracula is a globalized myth, because it is a globalized myth nowadays. We have Draculas in India. We have Draculas in Japan. We have a huge vampire culture, pop culture in Japan. We have Draculas everywhere, US, Germany, even in Romania. That's why I wanted to talk about. The presence of Dracula as a globalized myth nowadays is itself an effect of the Western gaze. The original Bram Stoker novel also was an exercise in balkanism. We will see that. The book carries with it, Dracula, carries with it its own story of balkanist discourse and Western prejudice. And oh boy, there are Western prejudices there in that novel. In other words, Transylvania itself became the other of Europe. It is, quote, the social and spatial other of the West. Stoker's Transylvania is a sinister, remote, backward region where evil and supernatural are wild, quote, end of quote. Transylvania is a border between the mundane and the extraordinary, other quote. Okay? Oh, these are the pictures. This is the Photoshop image of the famous Brown Castle, which is real, and of course, the fiction behind it, which is not real. It's Photoshop. So a real thing, it collides with, it's like in every tourist experience, a real thing collides with an exaggeration. Okay? This is real image from Transylvania, the village, a village with a fortified church in south of Transylvania. Okay. Rural landscape. So you can see, you may see these as cliches, but they are also truthful experiences. Because if you go there, I think you went there, it's great to you as a tourist. That's why it's so tough to make a grand theory about this tourist thing. Transylvanian forest. There are Transylvanian forests, not a cliche. It's a real thing. Yes. Transylvanian peasants. Well, this is a cliche because you don't have peasants living like this anymore. You had peasants like, I don't know, 100 years ago, 50 years ago, probably, that look like this. These guys do not look like this anymore. These guys are just for show here. And they are just dressing themselves for the tourists. So this is a cliche. Although these things are real. This popular dressing is real. I mean, it was real 100 years ago. Probably doesn't mean much to probably, or I don't know, I don't want to presume anything, but it probably does not mean as much as it meant 100 years ago. But this is real. This is ancient popular culture.
But in Maramuresh, people wear their
In Maramuresh, which is the most remote region in Transylvania, in the northern part of Transylvania, during the festive days of the year,
and Sundays,
which are religious, in some villages, which are also in that remote, the villages are the most remote, of course, inhabitants, peasants, put on their best dress for the church, for going to church. And yes, they put on their best traditional things. Yes. So, yes, there are some villages out there somewhere where somebody will dress like this. But this is mostly, I mean, except those locations, this is mostly a cliche. This is another castle. I mean, that's why Transylvania is full of castles. This is a very important one. This is the Hunyadi castles, where Dracula, the prince, was allegedly imprisoned during his reign. This is Bram Castle. The Bram Castle was designated as Dracula Castle. When, as tourists, when you go there, you'll just see, visit Dracula Castle. No, Bram Castle has no historical connection to Vlad Tepes. So it's just a castle made by the tourist imagination, as a Dracula castle. And yeah, these are images of Dracula Grand Castle. Okay, another one.
Yes.
Oh, this is a sample of Dracula tourism in Sikashara. Come visit the, well, this will be, you have Dracula restaurant. Yeah, this is a sample of.
So for just 5 lei, which is
like $1. Visit the room where Dracula was born. Yeah, this is a tourism made for the Western Gates. Yes. Restaurant.
I'm sorry.
Okay. This is a sample of globalized Dracula myth. So, but it's not the only myth. Dracula myth is a part of a ghost tourism tendency. There is a ghost tourism tendency. Dracula is also, because it is connected to the vampire myth, not just the blood vampire myth, it's also connected to things about the supernatural. I don't know, witches, and the undead, and the stake, and the, you know, all those things. But this is part of a trend in tourism nowadays. It's a niche in tourism, but it's very well kept. Ghost tourism, for example, is well established in England. There are some locations like Edinburgh or York where tourists go there to see ghosts. Yes, to see ghosts. As in Transylvania, they want to see the ghost of Dracula, of course. Yes, so renaming Bram Castle as Dracula's castle was an act, this is a quote from an English author, was an act of appropriation by the Western tourists. On their journey, tourists also often rely on expectation factors in mythology generated in and by their cultural origin, also a quote, yes. Yeah, I will not read this. I will just make a short survey on the issue. The problem with Dracula tourism was that the Dracula myth, the relation between the connection between the connection between Vlad Tepes and Dracula was not made by the book, by the Bram Stoker's novel. So before 1970, nobody knew that there was a Vlad Tepes, which was probably the source of the Dracula as a character in the novel. So that connection was not made up to the 1970s. What happened in the 1970s? In the 1970s, I don't have the book with me, I should have. It was too much. The guys from the customs said, no, too many books. What do you want to do? Do you want to do something illegal with these books? I will bring you the books on the next. I had like some books about the Gothic, you know? And yeah, the guys in the customs said, too many books. What do you do with these books? You know, you want to make some business or something with these books? No, it's just my books. Well, too many books. Okay, good. No, they didn't take them because they were written inside. I wrote on them inside, but they were new. For example, the Dracula which I bought was brand new. So what do you want to do? I want to do, you know, like, yeah. No, I don't want to do anything with them, but read. So what's the problem? What's the connection between Dracula and Vlad Tepes? The connection was made by a book written by two historians from the U.S. Well, one was of Romanian origin, Raymond Nelly and Radu Florescu. The book was written in 1972, and it was named In Search of Dracula. It was a bestseller in 1972, and it made the connection available to the American public. That book was a bestseller. It was based on a very deep research made by these historians, but it may well be that it's just a hypothesis. But that hypothesis caught up with the Western media, because McNally, for example, he was a historian at Boston College, and he was on many TV shows after the book. Well, you write the book on Dracula, of course you get highlights. You will get interviews in TV shows, and he got interviews in TV shows. And of course, McNally, because he believed in his theory, he explained to the American public that Dracula was Vlad Tepes, and all of them believed, of course. Well, the research, the scholarship behind McNally's book is very interesting, but it may have no connection whatsoever to the novel. So the scholarship was very good. I have the edition, I have the in Search of Dracula, and I have the 1989 other edition of the same thing, which, well, it was renamed. But it's a good scholarship. It's a very good and well-made scholarship, but it may well have no connection to no support for this connection between Vlad and Bram Stoker. And we will see why in our next lectures. I have a theory on this, on his, but the fact is that this myth was created there in that book. That book got to the public, that book got published, got publicized, and got media attention. And of course, in the 70s, at the end of the 70s, already the myth of Vlad Dracula and as of Vlad the Impaler as Dracula was made. What happened in Romania with this thing before 1989? In Romania before 1989 was ruled by a communist leader named Nicolae Ceaușescu. Nicolae Ceaușescu was a nationalist. At the end of his rule, he was a nationalist, autochthonist, if you want. Well, his regime had all the all the signs of North Korea. Almost all the signs of North Korea were there, especially his take on history, because the official communist nationalistic history said that Vlad Tepes was a hero. He was pure. He was a selfless leader, the leader of the people. Of course, this is the interpretation of the communist regime. The communist regime saw that leader as a selfless leader. He was a popular leader. He was a just man. He brought justice to the world. Of course, there is another thing here. This communist image of Vlad Tepes was not their invention. It was the invention of nationalistic history, Romanian history in the 19th century. So that image was just, how should I say, hacked by the communists, and they brought it from the 19th century Romanian history to their interests, of course, to the political interest. And of course, Ceausescu had the intention of comparing itself to Vlad Tepes as a selfless, just, and popular leader, of course. So this was a part of a very complicated ideology in that time, which was sustained by the state and also by the academy. The academia, the Romanian academia, didn't say a word against this official thing. The book about Dracula was written not in Romania, it was written in the US. So what happened out there? In 76, of course, because Ceausescu wanted to defreeze the relation between the US and Romania, he got visited by some American tourist agencies who proposed him to make a Dracula tourism in Romania. There is a story here. There were a bunch of guys who in the 1976, Americans, went to Romania to search for Dracula as part of a newly born Dracula tourism. What happened there was, of course, a story of absurd, as in any dictatorship. They were harassed, and they were driven out of Romania because Ceausescu changed his mind. He didn't want to take one blood Dracula and also his country to be seen as a non-modern country. He curiously and not quite logically associated the fact that one tourist comes to Romania and compares Romania directly to the country of which it was described by Bram Stoker. I mean, to me, it's not an argument, but to them, it was. So the Romanians, the communists, didn't want the Americans to see Romania as a primitive country. And also, they didn't want to see Romania as related to this myth. And what did they do? They blocked the whole thing. So they rejected the thing. The thing was that the first translation of Bram Stoker's novel into Romanian was done in 1993, after the fall of the Ceausescu regime in 1999. So you can see why was that possible. Because a Romanian publication of the Dracula novel was forbidden before 1989. So that was happening in terms of cultural policy, which Dracula during the communists. It was as one of the commentators, this is very interesting. This is an image of a movie about Vlad Tepes made by Romanians in 79. And you have the same movie with two different movie posters. The one is Romanian and the one is German. It's the same movie. You can't see the difference here. The difference is obvious. This Romanian version is fixated on Dracula as a leader, as a patriotic, unselfish ruler who fights for his fellow countrymen and punishes his enemies justly. He hates his internal aristocratic enemies, as well as his condescending, selfish, and greedy external enemies. This is the Romanian poster of the movie. This is the German poster of the movie. Of course, you see here the split between these two visions. Okay. These are friends from the movie, the main characters there. Well, this is Vlad, which is the good guy. This is the good guy. Yeah. This is the bad guy. He looks like the bad guy there. Yeah, this is the scared guy. You know, the scared guy there. He's the Sultan, and he was scared by, of course, by Vlad. These are the boyars, and this is the ambassador of the Sultan. Yes.
So that's the Hungarian king.
Yeah, this is the Hungarian king. It's Matthias Corvinus. It was Dracula's contemporary. Okay, so what was Stoker's Dracula reception in Romania after 1989? After 1989, this reluctance of the state in accepting Dracula's Tepeș wasn't so visible anymore, although a certain unease about the connection still lingered. In the meanwhile, Dracula tourism flourished and the culture of popular Dracula or pop Dracula exploded. State was caught up in a typical identity versus economy dilemma, and finally, tourist one. So you had this thing which was born in the communist regime, this identity versus economy dilemma. Identity versus economy means that Romania didn't want to be identified with Dracula, but on the other hand, after 1989, tourism had to flourish. So they had to accept that identity has to be put apart, because of course that was not the, in my opinion, that was not the good way of dealing with identity, but it's another story. But you have this problem, because Romania won during the time of the communists. Romania wanted to be associated. I mean, he wanted Romania, the Romanian state, the Romanian official wanted to associate Romania with a modern country. So they got this queer idea, this strange idea, this weird idea that if you bring Dracula tourists to Romania, Romania will not be seen as a modern country anymore. Okay, I don't argue with this. So, okay. However, this is another story. This is the final episode in the story, the Dracula Park story. So could Dracula reception, the Dracula Park story. In 2001, Romanian authority proposed the building of a Dracula Park near the historical city of Sticlișoara, the alleged birthplace of Tepeș. The association between Tepeș and Dracula was not forbidden or censored. However, Dracula Park turned out to be an implausible business plan. Well, also sparking a lot of domestic opposition, but the final word in this matter was UNESCO's. Because UNESCO became concerned about the project, since it was to be built almost a mile away from the center of Sighișoara Citadel, which is a UNESCO site. Finally, due to the strong opposition of UNESCO, Greenpeace, and EU Parliament, the project was terminated. So it was a very interesting thing here, because the Romanian government wanted to seem open about the Dracula issue, and they wanted to propose this Dracula Park. I mean, monster theme park. So they wanted to propose this Hollywood monster theme park. But the problem is that monster theme park was badly designed, was badly imagined, badly designed, the project. Because they wanted to, of course, for touristic reasons, they wanted to associate that Dracula Park to Sighișoara. They wanted to build the park near Sighișoara, near the ancient city of Sighișoara, the ancient part of the city. Of course, this project backfired. The Romanian government wanted to seem open about Dracula, but the project backfired also because of the Westerners. Because now the Westerners rejected the idea that the Dracula Park has had to be built in Romania. So this strategy was also a bad strategy for the Romanian government. So that's why this project was cancelled, was aborted. Okay, this is the city of Sighișoara. This is the ancient city of Sighișoara, as you can see, there are only historical, very, very old buildings, like 16th century. This is the tower there. So, of course, it's a UNESCO site, and you cannot build a Dracula Park near the UNESCO site because you will destroy the UNESCO site. Yeah, okay. This is the first translation of Dracula in Romania, into Romania in 1993. You can see here. I have this edition. You have this one?
Yes.
Yeah, you have this one. Also, you have to, you can make a comment about the picture, because the picture is like, ooh, I didn't get the picture until today. I don't know what that means. It's a mystery to me. It's a mystery. It's a supernatural mystery to me. Yes. So, meanwhile, one of the influences of Hollywood and vampire subculture, Dracula tourism and business in Romania flourished, creating a market of souvenirs that has become impossible. The problem is that this market of souvenirs is not under the under the control of the state, which is good. People out there, they saw that this image of Dracula was a good business, and they started to focus their interest, their artistic interest, into creating Dracula figurines and Dracula shirts. Mugs. You have coffee mugs, yeah. She has a coffee mug. So all these craftsmen, which are very, which are good at that region, Sighișoara, they all these craftsmen, they started to make Dracula souvenirs, Dracula memorabilia. But that was not a state thing. It was just a private thing. People thought about this as a, of course, as a source of revenue. Yes. So Romanian popular culture, eventually popular culture, not the state. I have doubts about the state still. Romanian popular culture eventually embraced the idea of Dracula as a fictional representation of the historical blood separation. I mean, to the popular culture now there is no, I mean, at large, at least there is no opinion against Dracula as blood separation. We embrace this idea, which is actually embracing a Western myth about Dracula. Okay. One big event, it was important. One big event was Coppola's Hollywood version of Dracula in 1992. You know that. I will talk about it in my last lecture. This version is a very interesting one because it rewrites the story. Really rewrites the whole story and the whole idea behind the Dracula as vampire of Bram Stoker's idea. It rewrites the whole story. It is the first heavily historicized version of Stoker's novel. Actually, in this movie, Coppola introduced blood separation to the audience. So it was the first movie, American movie, where the character blood separation was introduced as the character Dracula. So this is a historicizing of the myth. This is not a fictional creation or a recreation. No, this is a historicizing of, a making his story of the character. Since Coppola's Dracula, as you may well find or have already found, almost every filming version of the novel has tried to incorporate this historical character into the screen. So you have versions from 2001, you have Dracula, you have all these Draculas from 1992 on, all of them try to incorporate within their script this image of Vlad Sepeș. All of them, almost all of them. There is no, I have not seen a filmic version that does not incorporate this idea. So this idea caught up also with Hollywood movie, that the idea of Dracula as blood separation. So of course the filmic versions, the scripts are more or less accurate, of course, more or less correct, more or less agreeable, more or less pleasant. Well, it depends on the movie, but almost every filming version has tried to incorporate this character. Yes. Questions? These are actually, this is your homework.
what time do we have right now?
I think we have.
It's about quarter to seven. So what we thought we would do is give you a quick break and then come back and just have a small discussion around these ideas.
Yes.
So go, you know, get a drink of water, relax a bit, come back in just like 5-6 minutes, and then we'll have a discussion. And once we do that, then we, you know, the lecture will be over. Okay? So we'll take just a quick break.
Just a quick break.
So those of you who are listening online, if you also want to participate in the discussion or if you have questions, you can type them, and we have somebody standing by who can read the questions out loud so that Dr. Mahdi can answer them. So.
They come together now.
Yeah.
They didn't understand my reticence. Why am I so ambivalent about
this?
The
is truth history.
Yeah, but even there are all these.
Yes, because the Dracula myth has a lot, wasn't it? Which was converted by the Westerns.
Yeah.
And because it's that dilemma that we all have between our identity, which we may understand or not understand well, and the identity which is proposed. You know.
Yeah.
So either we have to accept it or accept both. I don't know. So it's a dilemma there. Do you accept the idea that Dracula is Vlad Tepes? Are you okay with this, or do you accept? Do you reject the idea and say, "Well, no"? To my opinion, it's not a question of accepting or not. It's a question of knowledge. That's why during my lectures, I will try to explain my version, my take on those things that McNally and Flores found in the book, because they have they made the connection lucrative.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Made sketchy. Very sketchy.
And then they spent more time with
history,
which is much more rich
history, but not with the connection.
Oh, the dishonor.
How do you feel?
Oh,
good. I'm tired.
Oh, okay. Probably, yeah. You're holding up well there. I was thinking, maybe he would be up for a drink after this, but
we had two beers last.
No, I had two beers. I mean, they were small beers.
Yeah.
I have two stout beers.
We went to cafe because of the altitude.
No,
I know.
So probably I'll split them and just pick you up at 8:45.
Yeah.
Best Western. University
Thanks.
Best Western,
yeah.
You know, and your waffles stay there. You were told.
No, oh, I didn't know that he stayed there.
Andy Warhol, Robert Rauschenberg, all Sam Francis, a bunch of the American Abstract Expressionists who are coming.
Actually a nice place to stay to really get a picture of.
It's part of the Fort Collins theme park.
Because the morning all the people gather there for breakfast, you get to see a lot of different
Americans. Hotel and motel, which is very interesting.
There are actually photos of him in the bed.
Was it room 203?
One second,
Okay, we're going to get started after Dan in just a moment.
Oh my gosh.
Just waiting for maybe two more people.
I think so.
Okay, let's go ahead and get back started. So before we open it up for the discussion around these ideas or questions, a couple things that I just want to say. First of all, thank you so much again to Dr. Mate for being here and presenting this. He's going to be doing a couple more lectures on the Dracula myth from some different perspectives, so I hope you'll join us for that as well. There's one on Thursday, I think. Friday, and Saturday. Okay, so please come to those, or you can tune in through BlueJeans if you like. So I just wanted to give a little bit of context for this as well. I thought this was a very well laid out and a wonderful introduction for what's coming up next. But for our perspective, you know, as cultural managers, leaders involved in policy, you can see some really important issues here and a little bit of attention. So Dr. Mate talked about the Western gaze on Romania. Romania is what we think of as being Eastern Europe, and it's very close to the East, which has some mythical kind of properties for us. So we look to the East as being exotic, and as far as that part of the East, the Eastern Europe, that it's kind of wild and barbarian from our point of view. So it feeds into that kind of romanticized notion and sort of an anti-industrial notion. So it's like going back to some earlier time or going back to nature, but in its wild manifestation. And so that's speaking from an American point of view, because Americans were very much part of making this myth happen, it feeds into our desires about what we would like to find if we go there, or even going there in our mind, and doesn't feed into the particular desires of the people who actually live there. So that's one of the tensions that we're introducing in the questions that Dr. Mate has posed that we can talk about. From that purely sensational point of view, when I think about like a Dracula theme park, it's like, yeah, I want to go there. Wouldn't that be fun? But on the other hand, you know, maybe there's some problem with that. I mean, we wouldn't want to go to, somewhere in Africa and do some mythologized. I had to get the accents and all the right syllables there. The mythologized version of some African myth and have it like a theme park, we would find that to be offensive to the people who lived there. So, you know, why is it that we would do such a thing to mythologize Eastern Europe in this particular part of it. So there's some tensions there, that is cultural managers and people involved in cultural policy we really want to think about. So with that introduction, let's look at these two questions and think about them a little bit, and let's get a discussion going. For those of you who are watching online, please type your questions into the chat.
One more
on the chat. Okay, can you read it to us? And maybe I'll go back and I'll read those out loud with my very loud voice.
Okay, so
it says, I don't have a question, just a comment. In answer to the first question, I think both economics and cultural policy are tied together. Imagining whether through tourism or other branding can certainly affect the decisions people make to spend money to visit and explore Romania. In the case of Dracula Park, there was clear opposition. Relating this to arts management, this brings up the importance of market research. So that's an interesting point of view, but what about market research? So suppose lots of people want to go to Dracula Park. I just said I would like to go to Dracula Park, but I also realize it's kind of problematic. So even if market research indicates they would want to do it, is it still something that we should do just purely from an economic point of view, or are there other issues? So just go ahead, Victoria.
Yeah, and I was going to say, and it's really portraying itself as a conflict of interest for me, because, yeah, as you said, the market research, a lot of people want to go there, but also from a point of a cultural policy, you want to have the cultural sensitivity, you know, and that's where it becomes the decision-making factor. If you want to preserve, you know, be sensitive to the culture there, debunk the myth, or do you want to cater to that, make the money, you know, at the cost of losing, you know, burying the actual culture.
Right, the cultural integrity.
Right.
So just in case people didn't hear, Victoria's just saying that there is this tension there. So yes, people might desire to go there, but you might be compromising the cultural integrity of this place, which is what UNESCO thought. They felt that it would compromise Sigishwara. You know, all of a sudden you would get a lot of touristy kind of restaurants and little shops in this ancient place that perhaps deserves preservation. So Mary, you had a comment.
Well, I think that in situations like this, you can take that uninformed desire that makes us all kind of want to go to a Jack Dracula Park. I mean, it is that I'm in the kitchen and I think it's fun, and I love to watch Nosferatu every Halloween, and because it totally scares me and creeps me out. But I think that historians and policymakers can actually take that desire and craft it to educate people and to create more sensitive cultural attractions. You know, like a museum that presents exactly the information that you've presented to us, so that people understand where this all came from. And still, it's exciting to me to go see castles and see a historic village from that century. We just don't have things that old in this country.
So basically, you agree that you have to do cultural policy, but with a historical interest, and not have a, well, it depends on the idea of what Dracula Park you want to do. I mean, if you want to do an attractions park or something like this, amusement park, it may backfire in terms of cultural policy, of course. But if you want to look at more closely and to get more serious about it, you can make it very interesting. I mean, I've seen, for example, I can make a connection with what I've seen in Romania now. For example, the Hunyadi castle, which I presented there, it was one of the castles, not the Brown castle. It was recently refurbished. Okay. Well, it didn't have some such
rich in historical information, but it still did have some